Well, again, we return to the subject that is at hand, the subject of resurrection. We began to look at that last Sunday night. And we're looking to understand that subject at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I told you last week that Christianity is the religion of resurrection. To a greater extent than it is anything else, Christianity is about resurrection. It is about the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ and the resurrection of believers to dwell with Him forever in heaven. But what most people don't know is that it is also about the resurrection of the ungodly to receive a body suited for eternal punishment. Christianity is a revelation of God's intention to raise everyone eternally. We will not be disembodied spirits. We will be spirits in a new body suited for eternal life. And when we look at resurrection, we have to go to the high point, and that is the resurrection of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And it is because of His resurrection, the demonstration that He had the power over death, that we believe our resurrection will come. Scripture is clear. Every human being from Adam to the last mortal will rise from the dead. Even the children of the devil, the unbelievers of all ages, will be raised from the dead with bodies suited for hell. Believers will be raised from the dead and given bodies suited for heaven. Resurrection, then, is the destiny of every human being. And it is no other than the Lord Jesus Christ who will do the raising. He will unleash His divine power to raise the dead. We read about that in John chapter 5, where we read that God has committed to Him all judgment and given Him the privilege of raising the dead, some to life and some to condemnation. What the Bible says about resurrection is not the typical religious belief. In fact, there are many who would reject wholeheartedly the notion of resurrection. Some religions and even some Christian cults teach a soul sleep, that when you die, your soul goes to sleep and perhaps, some would say, may awake at a later time. Others would say, even some religions, that for most people, in fact, all people who are unbelievers, there will be no resurrection, there will be termination. That is to say, they will die and go out of existence. Complete extinction. There are other religions who believe in reincarnation. You just get recycled. You come back, the same soul, in another form. Might be a rat, might be a cow, might be a human being, but for sure, if you messed up in this life, you're coming back as something worse. And the cycle can keep going downward, but it never ends. And then there is the ancient belief, along with termination or extinction or reincarnation, there's the ancient belief of absorption. It's not only ancient, it's very popular even today. Hindus and Buddhists teach absorption. What in the world does that mean? What it means is that when you die, your body goes out of existence permanently, and your soul, yourself, is absorbed back into the deity. That the universal deity from which we all are a spark is the deity to which the spark returns, as if a little spark landed on the sun and was completely engulfed in the massive sun itself. Absorption teaches that you lose your personal identity when you die. You, for all intents and purposes, go out of existence as you, and you're merely absorbed back into the deity from which you once came as a spark. This is not just something that is taught by Buddhists and Hindus. This is something taught by Christians, quote unquote. A well-known English Christian minister, who of course was an unbeliever, very famous man by the name of Leslie Weatherhead, wrote a lot of books. He said this, "Would it matter if I were lost like a drop of water in the ocean, if I could be one shining particle in some glorious wave that broke in utter splendor and in perfect beauty on the shores of an eternal sea?" That's absorption. That was taught by a Christian minister and believed by many. None of that is true. The Bible does not teach soul sleep. It does not teach any form of termination. It does not teach any form of reincarnation. It does not teach any form of absorption. You, as you, will live forever in a resurrected form with your own identity intact. And I remind you of Daniel 12:2, "Many of those who sleep in the dust of the ground will awake, these to everlasting life, but the others to disgrace and everlasting contempt." Everything that is now dust, that is all who have returned to dust, their mortal bodies in decay, will be raised to everlasting life or everlasting contempt. Now remember, the Corinthians were having a problem with this because the Greeks didn't believe it. The Greeks did not believe in bodily resurrection. They believed in the immortality of the soul, that the soul would live forever with a certain identity of its own, but that the body was evil. This is philosophical dualism, that whatever is material is corrupted because it's evil. And the worst possible thing to ever imagine would be that when you die, you get another body, because bodies in themselves are evil. So in Corinth, the dominating cultural idea of the immortality of the soul and the extinction of the body was then brought into the church by people who'd been converted from that Greek culture, come to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, but were struggling with the idea of physical resurrection. So Paul writes in this 15th chapter, the most thorough, comprehensive, doctrinal treatment in the entire 1 Corinthian letter. It's primarily a letter about practical life in the church, although there are some great theological truths, but there is nothing parallel to this chapter, where you have this long, drawn-out, extensive treatment of resurrection. And we remind you that the reason he takes such pains to do this is because believers are having trouble believing that. And you remember, I pointed it out last time just by way of reminder, that when Paul was talking to the Greek philosophers on Mars Hill in Greece and talking about the resurrection, they were shocked In Acts 17, 18, some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers, Greek philosophers, were conversing with him, and some were saying, what would this idle babbler wish to say? Others, he seems to be a proclaimer of strange deities because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. And they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, that's a hill, saying, may we know what this new teaching is which you are proclaiming, this teaching about resurrection. For you're bringing some strange things to our ears, so we want to know what these things mean. Now, all the Athenians and the strangers visiting there used to spend their time in nothing other than telling or hearing something new. That's what philosophy always does, because philosophy never gets to the answer, so it just waits for something new. And here was this new teaching coming from this man about resurrection. In verse 31 of the chapter, he says, God has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness through a man whom he has appointed, having furnished proof to all men by raising him from the dead. The judge of all men is going to be one who himself was raised from the dead. He will be the very one to raise all humans. Verse 32, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some began to sneer, but others said, we'll hear you again concerning this. This is new. This is connected with a strange deity. This is not normal. But it is the very heart of Christianity. God is gathering for himself an eternal family who will live forever in his presence in glorified bodies. What will they be like? We'll see that later in the chapter. But suffice it to say, they'll be like Christ's own resurrection body. Paul says that in Philippians 3. Jesus declared that he was the resurrection and the life. He declared that if you destroy this body, in 3 days I'll raise it up, and he did just that. As we saw this morning, he controlled his dying and he controlled his rising. He has the power of life and death. He said, no one takes my life from me. I lay it down of myself and I will take it up again. And because I live, he said, you will live also. So Paul, in this chapter, explains in tremendously rich detail the significance of resurrection. Let me read the opening 12 verses. Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me also. For I am the least of the apostles and not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me did not prove vain. But I labored even more than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? That is his opening statement. You already believe Christ was raised from the dead. How can you say there is no resurrection from the dead? As I pointed out last time, the Bible is the story of life and death and resurrection. And that includes not only human beings, but the entire creation, because we are told the Lord will destroy this universe. It'll melt with fervent heat, and He will create a new heaven and a new earth. There will be a resurrection for the entire universe, as well as all the humans who have ever lived in it. As Christians, then, we have to proclaim this. We have to proclaim to all men that they will be raised from the dead and given a body suited for hell to feel the pain of eternal punishment if they do not embrace Christ. It was Solomon Stoddard, who was the father-in-law of Jonathan Edwards, who said, "The dread of eternal damnation is the most and perhaps only effective means to lead sinners to true humiliation by a sense that their sin is deplorable in the light of God's holiness," end quote. He then went on to say, "We must preach so that there is the possibility of God-awakened conviction of sin." And then he said, "Follow that with the hope that Christ's grace is the only way to be delivered from that eternal judgment." Well, certainly the contemporary church has lost touch with that. We don't believe that the only effective means to lead sinners to true humiliation is to preach hell as over against God's holiness. We have to preach that. But even for us as believers, and that's what this chapter is directed to, the church, we as believers need to fix our hope on the coming resurrection. And we'll see why as we go through this chapter. We kind of wrapped up last week by referring to Colossians 3, "Set your affections on things above and not on things on the earth, for your life is already in heaven with Christ." We're not very heavenly minded, even as believers. We get all caught up in this world, all caught up in our mortality, all caught up in what the physical can be, with little thought for what is eternal. In 1 John chapter 3, we are given a wonderful promise. "See how great a love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God, and such we are. For this reason, the world doesn't know us because it didn't know Him. Beloved, now we are children of God, but it has not appeared as yet what we will be. But we know that when He appears, we will be like Him, for we will see Him just as He is." Your future as a believer is to be raised to have a body like the body of the risen Christ. That's your hope. You can rearrange this one, but the truth is you need a completely new body to dwell in a new heaven and a new earth. We need to be more resurrection-minded, less preoccupied with this world. So Paul wants us to understand the centrality of resurrection. So he opens in the verses that I read you with five distinct lines of testimony to the resurrection. And he starts with the resurrection of our Lord, because as I showed you in verse 12, if Christ has preached that He's been raised from the dead and you already believe that, then why are you questioning resurrection? That's going to be the focal point of his argument. So he opens in the beginning 11 verses with a line of testimony that Christ has risen from the dead. It is powerful testimony. First, and we looked at this briefly last time, is the testimony of the church. Let's look at verses 1 and 2, just a review. "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. And what is the gospel? Go down to verse 3. Christ died for our sins. He was buried, verse 4. He was raised on the third day. That's the gospel. I preached that gospel to you. You received that gospel. You stand in that gospel. In other words, you have settled your soul in that truth. You have built your life and destiny on the foundation of that gospel. You have therefore necessarily affirmed that Christ died for our sins, that he was buried, showing that he was really dead, and that he was raised on the third day. You already believe that. He takes them to what they already believe to show them what they necessarily then and consequentially must believe. Acts begins like this, the book of Acts. The first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after he had by the Holy Spirit given orders to the apostles whom he had chosen. To these he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of 40 days and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God. For 40 days after the resurrection, our Lord appeared again and again and again and again, proving his resurrection. You believe that, he says to the Corinthians. You believe that. You affirm that. You are believers in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is part of being a Christian. It's Romans 10, 9, and 10. If you believe in your heart God raised him from the dead and confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord, you will be saved. You can't be a Christian if you deny the resurrection. And there are many quote-unquote liberal Christians who call themselves Christians and even ministers who do not believe in the resurrection. Paul says to the Corinthians, your very existence as a true church is because you believe in the resurrection. And then in verse 2, he adds this, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, that is the gospel word about death and resurrection, unless you believed in vain. Paul strengthens his point that you can't be a Christian without believing in the resurrection by saying, if you do not believe in the resurrection, your faith is vain, useless, empty. Believing in the resurrection, listen, does not necessarily bring salvation. But not believing in the resurrection does necessarily bring damnation. The devils believe in the resurrection. Satan believes in the resurrection. The world is full of quote-unquote Christian people influenced by the fact of Jesus' resurrection. They may believe it, but they have not repented, confessed Jesus as Lord, and been saved. So to say it again, believing in the resurrection does not necessarily bring salvation, but not believing in the resurrection does necessarily bring damnation. The Corinthians had been transformed. Salvation was on display. Their faith was not fake. Their faith was real. All you have to do is go back to chapter 6 and verse 9, where Paul says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God. In other words, your salvation has taken place through your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's evident by the transformation of your life. You no longer live the way you used to live. So the very existence of the church and the transformation of every true believer is proof of the resurrection. Christ is alive, and He is transforming those who believe in Him. He had the power to rise from the dead, and He has the same power to give life to dead sinners and deliver them from their damning patterns of life. All true Christians know, all true Christians believe in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus and are living illustrations of spiritually endowed resurrection power. And that's a foretaste of the special physically endowed resurrection power that we'll experience in the future. So Paul's first argument is that the church, the very existence of transformed people, demonstrates that Christ is alive, because if they have been transformed, it's because they believed in His resurrection, and He, as alive, transformed their lives. Testimony number two, the testimony of the Scripture. Verse 3, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures." Now that opening verb, "I delivered to you," is a verb that needs some attention. Paul is simply saying, "I passed on to you what I received." This is what the apostle did. He passed on what he had received. This is how he viewed everything that came to him from God that he disseminated to believers. Back in chapter 11, when he was giving instruction about communion, the Lord's table, he said, "For I received from the Lord that which I delivered to you." So there he says it in reverse. "I received from the Lord, I delivered to you." Here he says, "I delivered to you what I received from the Lord." The message that Paul gave was from the Lord. It wasn't a humanly concocted message. Look for a moment at Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1, really a powerful chapter. Paul introduces himself and addresses the churches in the province of Galatia. Pick it up in verse 11. "I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man. I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my former manner of life in Judaism, how I used to persecute the church of God beyond measure and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my contemporaries among my countrymen, being more extremely zealous for my ancestral traditions. But when God, who had set me apart even from my mother's womb and called me through His grace, was pleased to reveal His Son in me so that I might preach Him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately consult with flesh and blood, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me, but I went away to Arabia and returned once more to Damascus. 3 years later, I went to Jerusalem and became acquainted with Cephas and the apostles." What I am teaching you, what I am telling you, I did not receive from any man. Remember, he was on the road to Damascus to persecute Christians. The Lord stopped him in his tracks, blinded him, called him, saved him, and then taught him by direct revelation for 3 years in Nabatean Arabia, after which, having been prepared by that revelation, he introduced himself to the apostles. And what was the message that was delivered to him? It was this, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Here is a Jew who is well-versed in the Old Testament Scriptures. He is a fastidious, zealous, fanatical Pharisee. He knows his Old Testament, educated by the finest Jewish scholar, Gamaliel, educated in the finest schools and synagogues. He knew his Old Testament. And he was taught by the Lord himself that the death of Jesus, the burial of Jesus, and the resurrection of Jesus was all in the Old Testament. Resurrection is promised in the Old Testament, not just the resurrection of the saints, as I read you in Daniel 12:2, but the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And by the way, a little phrase in verse 3, I delivered to you as of first importance, as of first importance, protois, protois. First things, the most essential reality, the primary thing. What is the primary thing? What is the primary message of the gospel? Christ died, he was buried, he was raised on the third day. Those are the three salient truths of the gospel. Those are the first things. Those are the priorities. And the phrase, for our sins, explains why. For our sins. He didn't die as an example. He didn't die as a well-intentioned martyr. He didn't die showing that you could triumph over evil. He died for our sins. Isaiah said that, didn't he? That's according to the scriptures. You say, where is that in the Old Testament? It's in Isaiah. It's in Isaiah 53, among other places, but certainly Isaiah 53. We've gone through some of this in the past. Verse 4. Surely our griefs he himself bore, our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Chastening for our well-being fell on him, and by his scourging we are healed. The Lord caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. The Lord was pleased, verse 10 says, to crush him, putting him to grief if he would render himself as a guilt offering. The Old Testament said, the servant of the Lord, they all knew it was the Messiah in Isaiah, the servant of the Lord. The Messiah would come and he would be slain for the sins of his people. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. And there's a whole lot of other pictures of his death all throughout the Old Testament in the sacrificial system that runs through all of the books of the Old Testament. This is the message of first importance. The Old Testament predicted the Messiah would come and die for the sins of his people. The Son of God came, died in our place for our sins, took our punishment, satisfied God's divine wrath so that God could forgive us. And then he was buried. He was buried. Why is that important? Because it proves he was dead. It proves he was dead. Verse 31 of John 19, the Jews, because it was the day of preparation so that the bodies wouldn't remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high day, asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and they might be taken away. Break their legs, they can't push themselves up anymore and they'll soon be asphyxiated. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first man and of the other who was crucified with him. But coming to Jesus, when they saw that he was already dead, they didn't break his legs. One of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. His heart had been literally pierced. There was no question that he was dead. These were experts in death. That's what they did. He was dead. Then verse 38 says, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but a secret one for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. Pilate granted permission. Pilate sent for information before he granted that permission to see if he was dead. He wanted to be sure that he was dead before he gave him to this man. Mark 15:44, Pilate wondered if he was dead by this time, and summoning the centurion, he questioned him as to whether he was already dead. And ascertaining this from the centurion, he granted the body to Joseph. He was buried. He was buried. There's no specific scripture in the Old Testament that tells us about his burial. That's why it doesn't say buried according to the scriptures. But if you're dead, you're buried. And they knew when someone was dead, clearly dead, unmistakably dead. There could be no error at that point. Then further reading in John 19, Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100-pound weight, and they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen wrappings with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. And they laid him in the tomb. They handled his body. They piled 100 pounds of spices on his body. They wrapped his body around and around and around and around. Clearly, he was dead. It's of essential importance that his death was established. It was established by the Romans, by the centurion, and even by those who cared for his body. He was dead. So he was buried. But he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Raised on the third day according to the scriptures. What scriptures talk about his resurrection? Well, you could go back to Isaiah 53, that wonderful, incredible statement. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see and be satisfied. He will see his offspring. He will prolong his days. Wait a minute. If he's dead, how will he see his offspring? When we were studying Isaiah 53, I pointed that out. We would all like to live long enough to see the subsequent generations that come after us. We'd like to know what our children's 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 children look like, and we don't see that. We die and leave this world. But our Lord purchased a family in his death, and he will see his offspring. God will prolong his days. He will see and be satisfied. Not only that, he will allot him a portion with the great. He will divide the booty with the strong. In other words, God will eternally reward him, which indicates there has to be a resurrection. When Peter preached on the day of Pentecost, if you remember that sermon in Acts chapter 2, it essentially was an explanation of Psalm 16. Peter's preaching, and he says, verse 24 of Acts 2, God raised him up again, putting an end to the agony of death, since it was impossible for him to be held in his power. For David says of him, I saw the Lord always in my presence. He's at my right hand so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad, my tongue exulted. Moreover, my flesh also will live in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to Hades, nor allow your Holy One to undergo decay. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. That's Psalm 16 predicting the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they preached the resurrection throughout the book of Acts. They preached the resurrection. Acts 4, they were speaking in the temple. The priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came to them, being greatly disturbed, because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in jail. That didn't change anything. Down in verse 10, Peter said, "Let it be known to all of you and all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name, this man stands here before you in good health." Speaking of the Messiah and quoting again from Psalm 118, "He is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, which became the chief cornerstone." You rejected him, but he became the chief cornerstone. And there's no salvation in anyone else, no other name under heaven whereby men can be saved. They preached Jesus and the resurrection as the fulfillment of the Old Testament scriptures. In chapter 10, Peter preaches in the book of Acts, just a couple of illustrations, verse 38. He opens his mouth and says, "You know Jesus of Nazareth, how God anointed him with the Holy Spirit and with power, and how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all the things that he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They also put him to death by hanging him on a cross. God raised him up on the third day and granted that he become visible, not to all the people, but to witnesses who were chosen beforehand by God. That is to us who ate and drank with him after he arose from the dead. And he ordered us to preach to the people and solemnly testify that this is the one who has been appointed by God as judge of the living and the dead. Of him all the prophets bear witness, that through his name, everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin." The prophets bear witness. Remember on the road to Emmaus, beginning at Moses, the prophets, and all the holy writings, he spoke of his suffering and his glory. Suffering and then glory implies resurrection. This is the message that the apostles preached through the book of Acts. It's all according to the scriptures. Testimony number one, Paul says, is the very existence of the church. They all believe in the resurrected Christ, and therefore they believe in resurrection. And then the testimony of Scripture. And then thirdly, the testimony of certain eyewitnesses. This is very, very important to the Apostle Paul. Starting in verse 5, "He appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me," and we'll get to that in a moment. Starting on the very day of the resurrection, according to Luke 24, he met two of his disciples on the road to Emmaus, and he was alive. And he went to their house with them, and he sat at table with them, and he revealed himself to them. And they declared that their hearts burned within them to commune with the risen Christ. Then that very night of his resurrection, he appeared in the upper room to all the gathered apostles, with the exception of Judas, who was long gone, and Thomas, who was not there. Human courts have always functioned best when provided with eyewitness evidence, especially intelligent, competent, objective, sound-minded eyewitnesses. So Paul appeals to this. The eyewitnesses are to be trusted. He appeared to Cephas. Cephas, that's Peter. That's Peter. He appeared to Peter. Cephas is Aramaic for rock. Greek is Petros, Peter. This is the first apostolic eyewitness. Luke 24, 34, "The Lord is risen," says Mary, "and has appeared to Simon." The Lord appeared first to the disciples on the road to Emmaus, then to the women at the tomb, and then the first apostolic appearance to Simon Peter. How gracious is that, since Peter was the one who denied him three times. This is the beginning of restoration. Thomas Arnold, 14-year head of the Rugby Academy in England, author of three-volume History of Rome, was appointed chair of modern history at Oxford in the past, said this, "The evidence for our Lord's resurrection has been examined by tens of thousands of persons who have gone through it piece by piece. I myself have done it many times, not to persuade others, but to satisfy myself. I know of no one fact in the history of mankind which is proved by better and fuller evidence of every sort than that Christ died and rose again from the dead." The great theologian Charles Hodge said it is the best authenticated event in ancient history. He was seen. He appeared, literally. He appeared to Peter. And not just Peter. Then to the 12. Even though there are only 11, Judas is left, they still sort of carry that name, and one will be added to take Judas's place early in the book of Acts. He appeared to them. He appeared to them again and again and again. That Sunday night of his resurrection, the following Sunday night after his resurrection, and this time Thomas was there. And then time and again, as I read you earlier in the book of Acts, over a period of 40 days, he kept appearing and appearing and appearing to them again and again. In Acts chapter 1, verse 21, "Beginning with the baptism of John until the day that he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." The apostles are saying we have to add somebody to take the place of Judas. They put two men forward, and they prayed, verse 24, "You, Lord, know the hearts of all men. Show which of these two you have chosen to occupy this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." They drew lots. The lot fell to Matthias. He was added to the 11 apostles. But the requirement, he had to be a witness with us of the resurrection. These are quality men. These are the best of men. These are not marginal eyewitnesses. These are the apostles, and they had repeated communion with the risen Christ. That's the quality. The quantity comes in verse 6. "After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep." 500 eyewitnesses, the majority of which are still alive. Some have died, but the majority are still alive. Testimony everywhere, eyewitness testimony. We don't know exactly where that happened. There may be good reason to think it was in Galilee, because that seems to be where that number of disciples actually existed, rather than in Jerusalem, where there were but 120 in the upper room. And what was the message of the 500? He's alive. He's alive. They were eyewitnesses. All the apostles, who were objective men, the crowd of 500, massive testimony. And they're still around to continue that eyewitness testimony. Finally, in verse 7, he appeared to James, probably not the apostle James or James the son of Alphaeus. Most likely, this is James, the brother of our Lord, the brother of our Lord. Why do I say that? Because in Galatians 1, we were there earlier, when Paul says in verse 19, "I went to Jerusalem," he said, "I didn't see any other of the apostles except James, the Lord's brother." So he did see James, the Lord's brother, and that may be the James he's referring to here. This is important if it's the Lord's brother, because they didn't believe in him. They actually thought he was crazy, according to Mark 3. But they had come to believe in him after the resurrection. So, all the apostles, that would be uppercase apostles, lowercase apostles like James, the Lord's brother, uppercase apostles would be the 12 and the one added. Lowercase messengers of the church, preachers, could be a lot more folks. All kinds of eyewitnesses in every direction. The Lord is appearing to them over a 40-day period after He came out of the grave. The evidence is mounting to establish the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ. Then in verse 8, and this is important, He turns to the testimony of a special witness. And this brings a new level of objectivity. Somebody might say, well, look, we expect the apostles to fabricate the resurrection. That's what the critics have always said. The apostles wanted it so badly they made it up, which of course is a lie. They didn't expect it at all. But there are some who say they were His followers. They wanted it so badly that they created it. They invented it. They concocted it. So their testimony is questionable. To settle that issue, we come to verse 8. He appeared last of all as to one untimely born. He appeared to me also. For I am the least of the apostles and not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and His grace toward me did not prove vain, but I labored even more than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God with me. Not only did I see Him, not only did He appear to me, but He turned me from a persecutor into a preacher. He transformed my life. Now, just to understand what he means by this, as one untimely born. What is that in verse 8? Literally, ta ektromati. Ektroma means a premature birth or an aborted fetus. In other words, it referred to a birth that wasn't correct. It wasn't in the right time. It was early. It was premature. Or perhaps even late and stillborn. Paul says, I'm a miscarriage. I'm like an abortion. What are you saying, Paul? I'm saying, I'm not the person who would invent the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I was on my way to persecute Christians when He appeared to me. You want objectivity? There's objectivity. Literally, he says here, he uses a definite article. He says, last of all, to me, the abortion. Me, dead, vile, lifeless, a worthless piece of flesh. Persecutor of the church, to me he appeared. To me he appeared. I didn't have any expectation of that. Back in chapter 9, he says, am I not an apostle? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? Yes, he saw him on the Damascus Road. But that wasn't the only time he saw him. Our Lord appeared to him on a couple of other occasions as well. And by the way, the Lord didn't appear to anybody but Paul until he appeared finally at the end of the first century to John. So when people say the Lord appeared to them, you can be sure it didn't happen. And it was an act of grace, verse 10, by the grace of God, I am what I am. It was grace that didn't prove vain because in the end that grace transformed me and I labored even more than all of them, yet not I but the grace of God with me. I was the least. I, nothing but an abortion, nothing but a vile, useless, dead thing. The least of all apostles, not fit to be called an apostle. Anti-Christian, anti-Christ. I didn't invent His resurrection. Why would I do that? I didn't have a hallucination. This is a problem if you're going to say the disciples invented it, because Paul says, he came to me and I was an unbelieving Christ rejecter. Shocking. I had no reason to invent that. He says, Galatians 1:22, I was still unknown to the churches of Judea, but they kept hearing, he who once persecuted us is now preaching the faith which he once tried to destroy. His incredible story of conversion comes in the 9th chapter of Acts on the Damascus Road. It's a shocking, stunning account of how the Lord picked him up and made him the apostle to the Gentiles and the author of 13 books of the New Testament. So look, did Jesus rise from the dead? You have the testimony of the church. The very fact that the church exists, it exists because they believe in a risen Christ. You have the testimony of the Old Testament scriptures predicting this, and Jesus brought it to pass. You have the testimony of multiple eyewitnesses, and then you have the testimony of a special, completely indifferent witness, the testimony of a transformed unbeliever. And then one other line of testimony, the testimony of the common message. Verse 11, whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. What do you preach? If Christ is preached, verse 12, that he's been raised from the dead, that's what we preach. We preach that Christ died for our sins, back to verse 3, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day. This is the testimony of the common message. They all preach the same thing. Whether it was I, the untimely born apostle, or all the others, we preach the resurrection of Christ, and you believe the resurrection of Christ. Then he brings it to conclusion in verse 12. Now, if Christ is preached that he's been raised from the dead, how do some among you say there's no resurrection of the dead? I mean, this is just a powerful, powerful argument. You've all heard the preaching of Christ who died and rose again. You have believed it. If Christ is risen, why are you questioning resurrection? He rose, and he is the first fruits of all who sleep. Verse 13, he says, if there's no resurrection of the dead, then Christ hasn't been raised. And if he hasn't been raised, then our preaching is vain. Your faith is vain. We're all false witnesses and liars. You believe Christ was raised. And so you already believe in a bodily resurrection. The resurrection of Christ is the first fruits, the prototype of the resurrection of all believers to eternal glory. More next time. Let's bow in prayer. Father, again, it's such a powerful portion of Scripture, and we feel like we're trying to get a grip on it and pour into it all that it deserves. We always fall short. Lord, we don't question the resurrection of Christ. You have granted us the truth concerning it in Scripture. You've granted us the faith to believe it. You've overpowered our spiritual deadness and ignorance. You've given us light and life. We glory in the resurrection of Christ. And because he lives, we will live. The first resurrection starts with Christ and encompasses all believers throughout all history. We'll all be raised with bodies like His. This is our message to the world. There is a life to come. You will live forever. You will have a body suited for heaven if you believe Jesus rose from the dead and confess Him as your Lord. And that is our shining hope. And Lord, it's because we have that hope of resurrection, a glorious resurrection into eternal joy, that we set our affections on things above and not on things on this earth. Lift us to the heavens above. May we not get trapped in the passing temporary vanities of this life. Help us to live with heaven in view and to rejoice already in what You've prepared for us, which You've guaranteed by giving us Your Holy Spirit. We thank You for the great and glorious hope and promise that awaits us. Give us eager hearts to that end, so that we may live lives that are so preoccupied with heaven that the first thing on our lips is to talk not about earth, but about heaven, even with those who don't know, but desperately need to know. We are citizens not of this world, but of Your kingdom. Heaven is our home. Our Savior is there. Our Father is there. Our life is there. Our hope is there. Our reward is there. Our true friends are there. All that You've prepared for us eternally is there. May we live in the light of that with joy and anticipation. Help us, Lord, to do that, we pray. In our Savior's name, amen. Now for tonight, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We come back to this chapter. This is a special series for a few Sunday nights from this great chapter on the resurrection. We have looked at verses 1 through 11 already, and tonight we come to verses 12 through 19. But I think it would be helpful for me to read the entire portion from verse 1 down to verse 19 because it'll set it in your mind. The Apostle Paul writes, "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that He appeared to Cephas," or Peter, "then to the 12. After that, He appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep. Then He appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And last of all, as to one untimely born, He appeared to me also, for I am the least of the apostles and not fit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and His grace toward me did not prove vain, but I labored even more than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God with me. Whether it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Now, if Christ is preached that He has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is vain, your faith also is vain. Moreover, we are even found to be false witnesses of God, because we testified against God that He raised Christ, whom He did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless, you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. Verses 12 to 19 is a fascinating approach to affirming the utter significance and importance of the resurrection of Jesus Christ as a foundation for believing in the resurrection of all people. The physical, bodily resurrection of the Christian is the end of Christian doctrine. It is the goal that God has established in His redemptive purpose. He is gathering from human history a people who will be with Him, not just in spirit, but in resurrected bodies in His presence to live forever, to praise Him, and to serve Him. Resurrection is critical to the culmination of God's redemptive purpose. The Old Testament even makes it clear, and you can go all the way back to the book of Job, chapter 19, verse 26, and hear the confidence of Job. He says, "And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I shall see God." Even in the time period of the patriarchs back in Genesis, they were aware of a coming resurrection of the dead. This was the promise of Jesus, who said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." When the apostles went out to preach the gospel of Christ, this is what we read concerning their preaching in Acts chapter 4, beginning at verse 1. "As they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to them, being greatly disturbed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead." That was their message, that believers would be raised from the dead in bodies suited for eternal glory. The Apostle John writes in 1 John 3:2 that that body will be like the body of Christ after His resurrection. We will be like Him, for we will see Him as He is. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 14, we read the words of the Apostle Paul, "Knowing," he says, "that He who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus." That has always been the hope of those who put their trust in the true God. The Apostle Paul even gives a direct promise in Philippians chapter 3, verse 20, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of His glory by the exertion of the power that He has even to subject all things to Himself." The same power by which He can subject the entire universe to Himself will be used to create transformed bodies like the body of the glorified, risen Christ. 1 Thessalonians, just one other text, verse 17, "Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. That is talking about a resurrection. The previous verse says, the dead in Christ will rise. So basic to our faith is resurrection. Christianity is a religion of resurrection. And I've been telling you that all people will be raised. Even the ungodly will be raised and given bodies suited for eternal punishment. But the message of Christianity is a message of resurrection. This body will go back to the dust from which it came, and God will give us a new body equipped for eternal life with Him in heaven. Now, we aren't having trouble believing that, but the Corinthians were. And I'm glad they were, because it allows for Paul to give us this powerful, powerful chapter which lays out for us the necessary understanding that we all should have of resurrection. In the culture of the Corinthians, the idea of a resurrection was horrible, because they believed that death was being liberated from fleshly bodies. They flatly were taught in Greek and Roman culture, dead men do not rise again. They believed in the immortality of the soul, but they denied the resurrection of the body. And we went through some of the literature, ancient literature, in which that was articulated. So there were people in the Corinthian church who were still having a hard time believing in the resurrection of the body. However, Paul begins by reminding them that they did believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It was in that resurrection that their salvation came about. And it was in believing in that resurrection that they embraced Christ. He says, this is part of the gospel, chapter 15, verse 1, which I preach to you, the gospel which you received, the gospel in which you stand, the gospel by which you are saved. And what is the gospel? That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that He was buried, that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. You already believe in the resurrection of Christ, so you believe in resurrection. They had not denied the resurrection of Christ, or they couldn't be saved. Romans 10, if you believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead and confess Him as Lord, you are saved. So he starts by saying, you already believe in resurrection, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is central to the gospel. And He has been raised so that we might also be raised. The resurrection of the dead is a promise to all believers. Now let's come down to verse 12, where he introduces this most interesting approach to affirming the resurrection in a negative way. If Christ is preached that He has been raised from the dead, you believed it, you received it, you embraced it, we, the apostles, have been proclaiming it. So if Christ is preached that He has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? How can you say, literally, there's no resurrection of corpses, that's the original. How can you say that? How can some of you say that, not all of you, but some of you deny the resurrection when you have already affirmed the resurrection of Jesus Christ? The idea was that the afterlife was strictly spiritual, that the afterlife was a kind of immortality that was the free-flowing spiritual nature of the person preserved everlastingly, but not a bodily resurrection. Paul is saying, if you deny resurrection, you have delivered a death blow to Christianity. In fact, he's going to take us through a negative approach to this with seven disastrous results of denying bodily resurrection. And they are progressive. It's quite a fascinating and unparalleled approach from the New Testament writer to do this. But let's see where he begins. We, verse 12, have been preaching Christ. We have been preaching, and you have believed that he has been raised from the dead. How is it then that some among you are saying there's no resurrection of the dead? You already have affirmed a resurrection from the dead in the case of Christ. So he goes back to Christ, and here are his seven ramifications of denying resurrection. Number one, Christ is not risen. Verse 13, but if there is no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. This is the first devastating fact that must be faced. If you deny bodily resurrection, then Christ is not risen. That is simply a logical deduction. This is a contrary to fact statement, and if that statement is accepted, as some in Corinth were accepting it, then there is no resurrection, then Christ did not rise from the dead. Now, when they're talking about resurrection, they're talking about a human being being raised from the dead. They're denying human resurrection. But Christ, after all, was a man. And that's the connection Paul wants to make. Christ was a man. He died as all men die. If men do not rise from the dead and he's a man, then he can't rise. That's the logic. If he is fully man, if the incarnation is true and he is fully man, and men don't rise, then he didn't rise. We could go back into the New Testament and find how constantly the New Testament identifies Jesus as man. He is a man, Acts 2:22, approved of God. 1 Corinthians 15:2 even says, by man came the resurrection. He is a man who was raised from the dead. Galatians 4:4 says he was born of a woman. 1 Timothy 2:5 says we have one mediator, the man, Christ Jesus. Hebrews 2:17, which we looked at this morning, says he was made like his brethren. He was observed to be a man. He was known by the people in his community, according to Mark 6:3, as the son of a carpenter. Even Pilate said in John 19:5, behold the man. John starts in his epistle, as we saw this morning, talking about the man, Christ Jesus, who is God manifested, and he was heard by John and seen by John and touched by John. He was a man. 2 John 7 says, if anyone denies that he is a man in his incarnation, that is a damnable heresy to be avoided. In fact, there is so much in the Gospels about his humanity that it's unmistakable. Conceived in a woman's womb, according to Matthew 1, born in a normal human manner, again in the first chapter of Matthew, circumcised, according to Luke 2, possessing a human soul, he even refers to his soul being troubled, Matthew 26. He possesses a human body, unmistakably, the testimony of John, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. In Luke 2:52, we find that he was growing in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. He is seen in John 11 weeping. In Matthew 4, he is hungry. On the cross, he is thirsty. In Matthew 8, he is sleeping. John 4 says he grew weary. John 11 identifies him as feeling sorrow and grief. In Luke 22, he was punched in the face with fists. Matthew 27 tells us about his scourging and whipping. He was nailed to a cross. He died as men die. He had his side pierced. He was wrapped in linen and buried. He was a man, fully human. He died as a man, and he arose as a man. That is critical for us to declare and affirm. In the 24th chapter of Luke, verse 33, they got up that very hour, returned to Jerusalem, found gathered together the 11 and those who were with them. This would be the disciples on the road to Emmaus, saying, "The Lord has really risen and appeared to Simon." They began to relate their experience on the road and how he was recognized by them in the breaking of the bread. And while they were telling these things, this is Sunday night of the resurrection, he himself stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought that they were seeing a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still could not believe, because of their joy and amazement, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it before them. He is demonstrating his post-resurrection humanity. He died as a man, and he rose as a man, albeit a man with a new body, but nonetheless a man. He is called in Acts the Prince of Life, whom God has raised. He came as a man, he died as a man, and he rose as a man. Paul's point is, if there is no resurrection of men from the dead, then the man Christ Jesus could not be raised. And that is a death blow to Christianity. And that leads Paul to his second point. All gospel preaching is therefore meaningless. All gospel preaching is therefore meaningless. Verse 14, "And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is vain, empty, meaningless." If Christ is dead forever, then the content of apostolic preaching is lost. The whole gospel is subverted. Christ declared that he would rise from the dead. If he did rise, then he is who he said he was, Son of God, Savior of the world. If he did rise, then his sacrifice on the cross was accepted. His substitutionary work satisfied God, and God raised him from the dead to validate that sacrifice. If he did not rise, then there is no validation that his death had any value. There is no indication that God is at all satisfied. If he did not rise, there's no good news to preach. There's no assurance that his death meant anything at all, because the resurrection is the validation of his accomplishment on the cross. Romans 1 begins, "Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, who was born of a descendant of David, according to the flesh, who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead." He is declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection of the dead. It is the resurrection that validates who he is. In Revelation 1:18, it says, Christ speaking in the vision to John, I am the first and the last and the living one, and I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. All of the Christian gospel is dependent on the resurrection. Romans 14:9, for to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. He had to rise to be the Lord of the living. The lordship of Christ is secured by his resurrection. Philippians 2 says that God exalted him, highly exalted him, gave him a name above every name, which is the name Lord, and at that name every knee bows. In raising Christ, God validated his atoning work. God demonstrated satisfaction with the provision he had made on the cross in our place. And God declared him to be Lord and gave him dominion over everything and everyone. The resurrection is critical to the gospel. This is the way God affirmed the work of his Son. To remove the resurrection is to destroy gospel preaching. If he did not rise, God was not satisfied. If he did not rise, he is not Lord. All gospel preaching is a sham. It is a hoax. There is no good news. He did not conquer death. He did not conquer sin. He did not conquer hell. The angels lied when they announced at his birth, "Behold, I bring you good news of great joy." If Christ did not rise, the news is bad. Another good religious man failed humanity. If there is no resurrection, then Christ did not rise. If Christ did not rise, all gospel preaching is meaningless. That leads Paul to a third point. Faith in Christ is worthless. Faith in Christ is worthless. Go back to that same 14th verse in 1 Corinthians 15. The end of the verse, "Your faith also is vain." And then he says the same thing down in verse 17, "If Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless," pointless. It's a delusion. This is an inevitable consequence. The apostles are preaching a risen, living Savior who provided an atonement which God accepted and validated, a risen and living Savior who is now Lord and provides for us forgiveness and eternal life and resurrection. That's the message of the apostles. That's what they ask you to believe, Romans 10. If you believe in your heart God raised him from the dead and confess him as Lord, you'll be saved. The dead cannot save the living. If Christ is not risen, faith in him is useless. It's as useless as the preaching. If the gospel is a sham and a hoax, so is faith in that gospel. It would be like Psalm 73:13, "Truly I have cleansed my heart in vain." It would be like following any false and damning religion. We might feel like Isaiah, who in Isaiah 49:4 said, "I have labored in vain, I have spent my strength for nothing." If Christ is not raised, then all gospel preaching is meaningless, and all faith is worthless. Not just yours, but everybody's. Think of Hebrews 11. Abel, who believed God, was a fool. Enoch, another fool. Noah, maybe the biggest fool of all, spending 120 years of his life in a monumental act of faith, only to die and perish. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, David, Gideon, Samson, Barak, Jephthah, Samuel, Elijah, Isaiah, Daniel, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, all the rest who believed God, who believed that God raised the dead, all had foolish faith. All those who by faith, the end of Hebrews 11, conquered kingdoms, performed acts of righteousness, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, from weakness were made strong, became mighty in war, put armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured, not accepting their release so that they might obtain a better resurrection. They were all fools because there is no resurrection. They're all dead. Those who were stoned, sawn in half, tempted, put to death with the sword, went about in sheepskins, goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, ill-treated, wandering in deserts and mountains and caves and holes in the ground. All of these, operating by faith, were fools. It's an empty faith. If God did not raise Jesus from the dead, all the martyrs of the New Testament, as well as the heroes of the Old Testament, all the saints of the ages throughout history down to this very day, all those who put their trust in Christ and in the gospel have been misled and deceived. If there is no resurrection, Christ did not rise. If Christ did not rise, the gospel is meaningless. Faith is worthless. And then a fourth point, the apostles are liars. The apostles are liars. He says that essentially in verse 15. Moreover, we are even found to be false witnesses of God, because we testified concerning God, literally, we testified concerning God that He raised Christ, whom He did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. Now, what was the condition, the one qualification apart from being selected by our Lord, what was the one qualification necessary to be an apostle? Acts 1:22. Any apostle had to be a witness of His resurrection, a witness of His resurrection. The apostles all were witnesses of His resurrection. In fact, at the beginning of chapter 1 of the book of Acts, they spent time with Him. They spent 40 days with Him while He spoke to them after His resurrection concerning the things related to the kingdom of God. They were with Him. They were with the risen Christ. That was their testimony. All the way through the book of Acts, the apostles are preaching Christ in His death and in His resurrection. If there is no resurrection, however, then Christ didn't rise. The gospel is meaningless. Faith is worthless. And all the preachers are liars. We are also, he says, found to be liars. We're discovered. The truth is uncovered. We are false witnesses concerning God. In other words, we are saying something about God that's not true. We're saying God raised Christ and God did not do that. This is a fascinating sort of dynamic here, because the apostles are pictured as witnesses brought into a court. And God is on trial. God is on trial. And God is claiming to have raised His Son from the dead. If that did not happen, then the witnesses who came in to declare that God did raise His Son have perjured themselves by preaching the resurrection of Christ if God did not raise him from the dead? Now, as we know, throughout the New Testament, it is often repeated that God raised Jesus from the dead. Also, that Jesus had the power of resurrection in himself. But often, God raised Jesus from the dead is the way it is revealed to us in Scripture. If God didn't raise Jesus from the dead, and we say he did, we are part of a conspiracy. We are lying, false witnesses. The resurrection of dead men, if it doesn't happen, then the resurrection of Christ didn't happen. The gospel is a lie preached by liars, and faith in the gospel is a hoax. And it all goes together. You can't just pull out the resurrection. Strange to think about it, but it is true that there are, within the framework of liberal Christianity, those who represent themselves as Christians and even pastors and theologians who deny the actual resurrection of Jesus Christ and carry on the Christian religion. The apostles, says Paul, if there's no resurrection, are not merely honest men who are trying to encourage people. They're not really honest men who, in sincerity, have given some information that they thought was good. Christianity's not advice. It's not some kind of spiritual insight. If they're preaching the resurrection and there is no resurrection, they are liars. They said Jesus rose. All the apostles, all the true Christian preachers, they've always said it, even to this very day. But the apostles said, we saw him. We touched him. We saw the nail prints. We saw the scar in his side. We watched him eat. We were with him for 40 days. But if the dead don't rise, then Christ didn't rise. They're all liars. And that means the whole New Testament is a hoax. It's all a lie, all gospel preaching, and all call to faith in Christ is a damning deception. It's just another false religion. And oh, by the way, do you remember back in verse 3 of 1 Corinthians 15? Paul said, I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. That means that not only are the New Testament preachers liars, but the Old Testament prophets are liars. The psalmist in Psalm 16, who said he will not allow his Holy One to see corruption, but will show him the path of life, resurrection, was a lie. Turn for a moment to the 53rd chapter of Isaiah. It was in that chapter that Isaiah talks about resurrection without using the word. We know Isaiah talks about the Lord's death. He will become a sacrifice for sin. He was oppressed, verse 7, he was afflicted like a lamb that is led to slaughter. He didn't open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living? Being cut off, it's an old expression for death. He was cut off out of the land of the living. Verse 9 mentions his grave, as we saw this morning. It was supposed to be with wicked men, but he ended up with a rich man in his death because he was buried in the tomb of the rich man Joseph of Arimathea. Clearly, he is dead. The Lord was pleased that he would die. The Lord was pleased, verse 10, to crush him, to render him a guilt offering like any other sacrifice offered as a death on the altar. However, verse 10, he will see his offspring. He will prolong his days. And the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see and be satisfied. Verse 12 says, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors, bore the sin of many, interceded for the transgressors. How can someone who is dead see his offspring, future generations? He can't. He can't have his days prolonged. He can't see into the future. He can't receive an inheritance with the great and booty with the strong unless there's a resurrection. If you say that Christ did not rise, not only are all the New Testament preachers liars, but the Old Testament prophets are liars as well. And more importantly, since God claims to be the author of Scripture, God himself is a liar. Proud liberal theologians who deny the resurrection literally destroy Christianity to the degree that there's nothing left. They need to abandon this religion altogether. I was reading an article 2 days ago. If Jesus were living today, would he become a part of Christianity? Would he identify with Christians? The writer's answer was no. No, he wouldn't, because Christians are too concerned about social issues and not concerned enough about love and compassion. And that's demonstrated because they make such an issue out of abortion and homosexuality. If Jesus were here today, he wouldn't want to become a Christian because he wouldn't want to be connected to people who lack love and compassion. This is written by a Christian. If Jesus doesn't rise from the dead, you have no Christianity at all. To reduce Christianity to some kind of benign love and compassion to be defined by every person according to their own moral standard is not Christianity at all. The preachers in the New Testament are liars. The preachers in the Old Testament are liars. God himself is a liar. Even Jesus is a liar. In the 16th chapter of John's Gospel, verse 13, just a few verses there, but when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own initiative, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will disclose to you what is to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of mine and disclose it to you. So not only, if there's no resurrection, not only is God the Father a liar because he didn't raise Christ, not only is Jesus a liar because he said he would rise and he didn't, but the Holy Spirit, who is the author of Scripture, which says he rose from the dead, is himself a liar, and God is the devil. Just to reset, Paul reaches back in verse 16 and re-grips his premise. If the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. If the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. That sets us on the same trajectory. If Christ is not raised, then the gospel is meaningless. Faith is worthless. Preachers are liars. God is a liar. Christ was a liar. Holy Spirit, author of Scripture, is a liar. There is a fifth serious issue if Christ did not rise. Sin is unforgiven. Sin is unforgiven. Verse 17, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless because you are still in your sins. If Christ didn't rise, listen, sin killed him, and sin held him, and sin defeated him. He is a condemned Christ, not a justifying Christ. If he did not rise, death won. And if death won, sin won, because death is the wages of sin. For us to have forgiveness, someone had to conquer sin. Paul says if he didn't rise, he didn't conquer sin. And you are still in your sins. You are captive to the deadly sphere where all your sins surround and engulf you and accuse you before God like so many wolves about to tear you to shreds. If we want any hope of heaven, if we want salvation, we need a Savior who can free us from our sins, a Savior who can bring to us the full forgiveness of our sins. If there's no resurrection, then there was no satisfactory payment for sin. If there's no resurrection, there was no atonement. There was no redemption. The penalty was not paid in full. If the penalty is not paid, there is no reconciliation with God. There is no justification. There is no salvation. There is no life. If Christ is still dead, then we are all trapped in sin. But Romans 4:25 says, he was raised for our justification. If the dead don't rise, then he wasn't raised and we aren't justified. Romans 4:25, he was delivered over because of our transgressions and was raised because of our justification. Again, in Romans the 8th chapter, verse 33, who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is he who died. Yes, rather, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. If he didn't rise, he's not at the right hand of God, interceding for us. Only as the risen Christ can he be the object of our faith. Backing a little further toward the beginning of Romans chapter 6, verse 3, do you not know that all of us who have been baptized or immersed into Christ Jesus have been immersed into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin, for he who has died is freed from sin. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again. Death no longer is master over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all, but the life that he lives to God. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. That's because we died with Him and we rose with Him. Only a living Christ can be to us wisdom and sanctification and righteousness and redemption. He is the only one to turn to. There is no other name, Acts 4:12. If He can't do it, no one can. Christ not risen dooms and damns everyone. We are all without hope. In the words of Jesus Himself in John 8:21, you will die in your sins, and where I go, you will never come. The resurrection is so critical. On the cross, the Bible says, the apostles say, the gospel declares that Christ paid the penalty for sin, took upon Himself the full fury of God's wrath, and conquered death and sin. It was demonstrated in that He rose from the dead because the grave could not hold Him. Sin had no power over Him. Hell's carnival ended on the third day. He conquered sin for us. That is the gospel message. And in conquering sin for us, He conquered death for us. Again, the apostolic preaching, Acts 5, Peter says in Acts chapter 5 and verse 29, we must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom you had put to death by hanging Him on a cross. He is the one whom God exalted to His right hand as a prince and a savior to grant repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey Him. I love that word, prince. God exalted Him as a prince, an archegos. That's a very interesting word. Used a number of different ways in ancient Greek. One I found interesting was that ships had a seaman on board who was considered to be the archegos. That word meant pioneer or forerunner. It was a crew member who was a strong swimmer. If anything ever happened to the ship, this archegos would tie a rope around his waist, dive in, and swim to shore. He would find a place to attach the rope so that all the others could come along the rope to shore to safety. Jesus swam the waters of death and anchored the line for us. But if He drowned, we all drown. There's no line, there's no hope. He's certainly not interceding for us. We are damned and we have no one to help. No one at all. There is a sixth statement that the apostle makes. If Christ did not rise, the dead in Christ have eternally perished. Verse 18, because you're still in your sins, then those who have fallen asleep, that's a phrase referring to death, in Christ, believing in Him, have perished. They've all gone to hell. Peter, James, John, Paul, all the apostles, all the early preachers, all the great preachers through history, the ancient preachers, the ancient fathers of Christian faith, the reformers, like Luther and Calvin and all the rest. They're all in hell. Hell holds them all. Satan wins, God loses. They've all perished. When all the believers close their eyes in death, full of hope that they're going to open their eyes and see Jesus, it never happened. They perished forever, never saw the one their souls loved, opened their eyes and saw nothing but fire, a kind of fiery darkness in hell. This is a crushing argument. The horrible consequence if Christ is not raised. If there is no resurrection, Christ is not risen. Gospel preaching is meaningless. Faith is worthless. Apostles and preachers are liars. Sin is not forgiven, and dead believers are damned. And then there's one more to wrap it up. Number 7. Christians are the world's most pitiful people. Verse 19, if we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. If all of our hope in Christ was only for this life, only for here and now, we put all of our trust in Him, we are a pitiful lot of deluded souls. We've wasted our entire lives. Like every other false religion in the world, all meaningless. We have managed to live in illusion, and we gave up our life for it. We fight against sin, we fight against temptation, we struggle to please God, we study the Scripture, we desire to obey the Scripture, we bear the cross, we suffer reproach for Christ, we make sacrifices, we give, we serve, and it's all an empty dream. We are pitiful people. If that's all it is, just something for this life, what a waste. What a waste. And then there's verse 20. But now Christ has been raised from the dead. The first fruits of those who are asleep. For since by a man came death, by a man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all will be made alive. But now Christ has been raised from the dead. The resurrection is a reality. The resurrection is a reality. That means that the gospel is true, faith is priceless. The apostles and prophets and Christian preachers proclaimed reality. Sin is forgiven. Believers who die are taken into eternal glory. And we are, of all men, most everlastingly blessed. I hope you have a new joy when you think about the resurrection. Father, we are grateful Again, as always, for the glory of your word. It explodes on our souls and our minds with its transcendent beauty and magnificence, clarity and power. We look forward to the resurrection. We can say, for to me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. We long for that day when we leave this body and we receive a transformed body like the body of your glory, O Lord, your resurrection glory, a body that will be suited for things that we can't even imagine, everlasting blessings, everlasting, holy, perfect, righteous adventures that though they last forever will never be enough. Thank you, Lord, for life eternal. Lord, we ask that you would give us a fresh and new gratitude for the resurrection, and that we would not forget that there are many who will rise to receive a body suited for hell, and we're called to proclaim the truth to them about death, about judgment, about resurrection unto judgment, and then about the gospel of grace. It's our desire, Lord, that you would use us to bring people, to snatch brands out of the burning, bring people to the knowledge of the gospel and the glory of the resurrection. Eye has not seen, nor has ear heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man the things that you've prepared for those that love you. But we know that those things are going to be lavish, everlasting expressions of your kindness and grace and love and mercy. And they will be enjoyed in a glorious, resurrected form by all who put their trust in you. Make us truly a people of the resurrection. Help us to talk about resurrection with friends, people we know. Help us to take Christianity to that point, that it's not just about fixing issues in this life, here and now. Some of those never get fixed. It's not about sucking the best out of the time here. It's about living with the shining hope of resurrection unto eternal life. Help us to set our affections on things above and not on things on the earth. We look forward to the time when we're made like Christ and see Him as He is. The gift of salvation overwhelms us. We are unworthy, undeserving, humbled, and grateful for such grace. And we desire to honor you and serve you in such a way that reflects our gratitude, by obedience, by worship, by joy, and by eagerness to communicate gospel truth. Use us to that end, we pray, Lord. We ask these things for your glory. Amen.